Hello everyone. It is a great pleasure to share my experience with PSMA PET-CT imaging and to speak about the role of PSMA PET for defining non-metastatic versus oligometastatic versus systemic prostate cancer disease. I would like to thank Telix Pharmaceuticals and the AdmiTech Foundation for the opportunity to speak here today. First, a disclaimer, unless otherwise noted, none of the agents mentioned in the speaker's presentation is approved for use in the US or any other jurisdiction. And all of the content within the following presentation is the sole opinion and experience of the speaker, myself, and not that of Telix Pharmaceuticals. So, PSMA PET, as you know, the diagnostic performances are now well established. It is now pretty clear that PET imaging of the PSMA target is the most accurate and sensitive imaging modality for prostate cancer staging compared to conventional imaging, CT and bone scan, compared to Colleen PET, and now even more recently compared to Fluciclovine PET. So with a more sensitive imaging tool, we need to redefine each disease stage. For example, if we look at the non-metastatic castrate-resistant prostate cancer patients, population used for the registration trials of enzalutamide, apalutamide, or darolutamide, so a pretty big deal. Well, they were defined as non-metastatic by conventional imaging, CT and bone scan. In a study that looked at the PSMA PETs of 200 patients with the same characteristics than the population of the Spartan trial, PSMA PET detected metastatic M1 disease in 55% of the study population. So now they are M1 by PSMA PETs, so they are not non-metastatic patients anymore. They are mCRPC. But these patients are still the ones who benefited from apalutamide in the trial, so we should still give them the drug, especially that first-line treatment strategies for non-metastatic castrate-resistant prostate cancer and metastatic castrate-resistant prostate cancer have now become comparable. It's just that the definition of metastatic versus non-metastatic disease needs to include now maybe with which imaging modality it was done, maybe we should say in the label of a drug, non-metastatic by conventional imaging or M1 PSMA PET, something like that. We can even consider to use PSMA PET for the castrate-resistant definition. Diagnosis of castrate-resistant disease, as you know, requires repeat PSA measurements with a minimum threshold of 2 for EAU guidelines or 1 for PCWG criteria. And in a recent study of 55 patients with rising PSA under ADT, but at low PSA values under the guidelines thresholds, PSMA PET was positive in 75% of the patients, whereas CT was positive in 33% of the patients. So by seeing new active lesions on PSMA PET, these patients are not castrate sensitive anymore. And there was also a stage migration to M1 disease in 45% of the patients. And so by seeing active distant lesions now on PSMA PET, these patients are even mCRPC now by PSMA PET. So again, another redefinition we might consider also. Now, so PSMA PET is very sensitive. It's the most sensitive imaging that is currently available and sometimes can pick up very tiny lymph nodes, metastasis of about 2 to 3 millimeters. As long as there is sufficient PSMA target density in the lesion. Here is an example of a left perirectal lymph node and a left supraclavicular lymph node of about few millimeters only, and that were highly PSMA PET positive. So it's quite frequent to see that. Now, careful, PSMA PET has the same limitation than any other PET-CT technique, and you cannot go beyond the detection limit of PET. This very famous picture or figure for FDG PET shows that under 10 to the 7 cells with FDG uptake, PET is not able to detect a lesion. And we can do more or less the same with PSMA. And that is why we still see only the visible part of the iceberg on PSMA PET as well in many patients. Here is a study that looked at the size of the tumor deposit here on the x-axis and the detection rate by PSMA PET here on the y-axis. It has been shown that 90% of the lymph nodes with a tumor deposit of 5 millimeters or more can be detected by PSMA PET, whereas only 50% of the lymph nodes with a tumor deposit of 2 millimeters or less are detected by PSMA PET. So when a PSMA PET scan comes back negative, it can mean either the patient has no disease or the disease is just too small to be seen. And you cannot really make the difference. You just have to know it and put in factor other characteristics. And that is why for pelvic nodal disease detection at primary staging before surgery, the sensitivity is only 40% when compared to histopathology gold standard. So most of these patients here in these studies were negative by MRI and CT. So in a way, a sensitivity of 40% is way better than zero, but it means we still means 2/3 of the patients with micrometastasis. This is just too small to be detected, and we still see only the visible part of the iceberg in some patients. Having said that, and keeping that in mind, now let's talk about oligometastatic disease. I choose to show here probably the most famous trial that you all know, the randomized STOMP trial in 62 patients. Patients who receive choline PET-directed therapy up to 3 metastases necessitated medical castration 8 months later than patients under surveillance only. And recent updates of the 5-year outcome follow-up were presented at GU ASCO early this year with, as expected, a much higher ADT-free survival in the intervention group and also a higher castrate-resistant disease-free survival in the intervention group. I show here also the OIL trial that was out this year. This was done with a threshold of 3 metastases as well, but this time with conventional imaging. The trial was positive. There was a significant higher PFS in the intervention group. Patient had a baseline PSMA PET, but it was not used for therapy planning. The intervention team was blinded to the PSMA PET scan. They did the radiation therapy based on standard imaging, and then they compared patients with radiation fields covering all the lesions visible by PSMA PET versus patients with lesions on the PSMA PET that were not treated or not covered. And they found, logically, that patients who had lesions visible on the PSMA PET scan not covered by the radiation therapy fields was much worse. So if you want to do oligometastatic directed therapy, you better need to use PSMA PET rather than conventional imaging. Here is an interesting Italian multicenter study that compared the outcome of patients with oligometastatic disease treated with choline PET guided radiation therapy versus PSMA PET guided radiation therapy. 44 patients in each group, 25 months of follow-up. It seems, again, that PSMA PET does a better job. In this Turkish multicenter study of oligometastatic PSMA PET guided radiation therapy in 176 patients, we can see that the more you have met, the worse you do, and patients with a single met do better than the others. In our practice with PSMA PET at UCLA since 2016, we do have nice stories of PSMA PET guided therapy. For example, this patient with biochemical recurrence at a PSA level of 0.6 had a single rib metastasis that was treated with focal radiation therapy without any ADT. Last PSA in August at plus 26 months is still undetectable. Here's another one with biochemical recurrence at a PSA level of 1.6 who had a single left perirectal lymph node metastasis treated with radiation therapy only without ADT, and now PSA at 3 years remains undetectable. So these are good stories where it seems that the disease you see on PSMA PET is the whole burden of disease of the patient and not just the visible part of the iceberg. But when you look at the study who followed patients treated with oligometastasis PSMA PET guided radiation therapy with a restaging PET afterwards, you can see that progression is mostly driven by out-of-field relapse with new metastasis and not in-field. These lesions were probably too small to be seen at the time of radiation therapy planning, and you have new lesions coming out elsewhere. And you also have other types of story. Here is a patient who had biochemical recurrence 1 year after surgery. The first PSMA scan showed nothing, and he started apalutamide. After a first response, PSA increased again, and patient underwent another PSMA PET, which showed a local recurrence. He received salvage radiation therapy and responded well, as shown by his PSA drop and his follow-up PSA. But PSA increased again, and a new single bone metastasis was discovered in the right femur on a fruciclovin PET. He received focal radiation therapy to this lesion and had also a good first PSA response. But after this response, new metastasis appeared in the ribs, as seen on this follow-up PSMA PET. And a few months later, he's now starting a clinical trial for mCRPC disease. You can see numerous metastases, some exhibiting high glycolytic phenotype, as seen on the FDG scan. So here with this case, you can see the underestimation of the disease burden with fruciclovin PET. The bone mets in the femur was also probably bigger than what was seen on the fruciclovin PET here. And also you see likely biologic behavior changes or mutations of the disease of the patient with a much more aggressive pattern coming out at some point. So different stories. PSMA PET diagnostic performances are now well established. And with more sensitive imaging technique, we need to redefine disease stages and find how to integrate these new patterns in the treatment algorithms. So the main challenge for the oligometastatic disease PSMA PET guided therapy now is how to make the difference between a true oligomacrometastatic patient and a polymicrometastatic patient. Also, the threshold of 3 versus 5 met is somehow arbitrary and needs to be assessed depending on maybe on the disease stage or and which imaging modality you use, and how to integrate the stage migration with new imaging tracers most sensitive. Patient is maybe non-metastatic by conventional imaging, then oligometastatic by choline or fruciclovin PET, and polymetastatic by PSMA PET. At the end, overall, I'm sure that PSMA PET will improve the outcome of patients with oligometastatic disease, and that robust studies will show it soon. With this, I would like to thank all my collaborators and team and the organization for inviting me to give this presentation. Thank you very much.